Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Dearly beloved, in order to prepare our hearts to celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God, devoutly and meekly. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against thee in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved thee with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry. We humbly repent. For the sake of thy Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in thy will and walk in thy ways to the glory of thy name. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who have heart of repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon, and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you unto everlasting life through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Give unto us the increase of faith, hope, and charity, and that we may obtain that which thou dost promise. Make us love that which thou dost command, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Leviticus. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, 'You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. You shall not render an unjust judgment. You shall not be partial to the poor or defer to the great. With justice you shall judge your neighbor. You shall not go around as a slanderer among your people, and you shall not profit by the blood of your neighbor. I am the Lord. You shall not hate in your heart anyone of your kin. You shall reprove your neighbor, or you will incur guilt yourself. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the first letter of Paul to the Colossians. You yourselves know, brothers and sisters, that our coming to you was not in vain, but though we had already suffered and been shamefully mistreated at Philippi, as you know, we had courage in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in spite of great opposition. For our appeal does not spring from deceit or impure motives or trickery, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak not to please mortals, but to please God who tests our hearts. As you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery, but with a pretext of greed, nor did we seek praise from mortals. Whether from you or from others, that we might have made demands as apostles of Christ, but we have gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also ourselves, because you have become very dear to us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" He said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind."
This is his last debate with the religious authorities, just days before his arrest, just days before his death. It debated the Herodians, it debated the Sadducees, and now a lawyer from the Pharisees comes to him, asking a question. And though the motive of the question came from ill intent, to test Jesus, possibly to trap him, the question, as what we would say, was meet and right. It would be a common question, a common exercise among rabbinic Judaism in that day, that is to muse and to come up with aphorisms, to sum up the complexities of the great law of Moses. Remember, there were some 613 laws of Moses. 365 negatives, thou shalt not. It's 248, thou shalt. That's a lot of law. And what we, Western Hemisphere 21st century Christians, fail to comprehend is the preciousness of that law in the heart of a Jew living in the time of Jesus. I often say, if we want to have just a glimpse to what the law meant to the Jewish mind, read any six verses of Psalm 119, the longest psalm in the Bible, a psalm dedicated to the law of God. My favorite image that I think encapsulates the very spirit of Psalm 119, what it has to say about law, is the image of a fish. A fish lives in the law of water. And in that, the limitations of water, a fish is free and swims and enjoys life. It lives, it thrives, it has its fishiness. And in the limit of water, the fish is a fish. But let's just say a fish is given what we have, free will. A fish could say, you know what? There's a world out there that I don't know. There's air, there's tree, there's land. I will live there. The grass looks greener. And it jumps up, but what happens? A fish has gills. A fish is made to live in the law of water. And outside of that law, the fish suffocates and becomes ill and dies. And so it is with the creature of God. We are made to live in the freedom of law. And so the Jewish mind would, when exercising, think, what is the consensus of the law? It is said that Psalm 15 reduces it to 11. Isaiah, the 33rd chapter of Isaiah, reduces it to 6. The 6th chapter of Micah reduces it to 3, my very favorite. And what, O mortal, does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and walk humbly with your God? And it's said that the 2nd chapter of Habakkuk reduces it to 1. The righteous will live by faith. And so it would be a familiar question to ask Jesus, what do you say, Jesus? What is the great commandment? And from the wisdom of his mind, the love of his heart, the spirit of his soul, Jesus gave us two commandments brought together that has changed religious life forever, forever and forever and forever. He first went to the 6th chapter of Deuteronomy, to the central prayer of Judaism, pray twice a day, to the Shema, named after the very first word of the prayer. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And then he forever and forever connected to the 19th chapter of Leviticus that was in our Old Testament lesson today. The law regarding our treatment of other human beings. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. He forever and forever combined our devotion to God with our treatment of other human beings. Stephen Vincent Benet's novel, John Brown's Body. By the way, the Benet family were faithful prisoners in this parish. There's a beautiful plaque in the entrance of the church dedicated to them. But in his novel, John Brown's Body, he pictures a slave ship captain, devout to his prayers, devoted to his piety, loving the Lord with all his soul, mind, and body, but with no sense, no connection, no realization to the horrific traffic that he was doing, to what of which he was responsible. And we stayed at such an image, agog and aghast. We say, oh, but there before the grace of God go you and I. And indeed, we are that image every day, perhaps not that dramatic, but every day of my life, I find it difficult, if not impossible, to love God with all my heart, mind, and soul, and to connect that to the treatment of other human beings. If it's not impossible, it is the most difficult thing ever. And so, if Jesus gave us this law, and if we're ever connected to these two principles, and if it is non-negotiable, and if it is almost impossible, how do we do it? And thus I come to the point of the sermon. I'm going to take off my mask for two words. May I do that? Because this is how we do it, one way. A parish. A parish. We're placed together in a community, in a parish, and that is how we fulfill our Lord's commandments. If you ever have a fireplace, you have charcoal and it's burning, and one charcoal is separated by itself, what happens? The charcoal cools and dies. But when placed next to the other embers and charcoal and fire, it stays warm. That is what a parish gives to us. It's not perfect. No parish is. If you look for a perfect parish and you find one and you join it, it's not perfect anymore. But it is a gift, because faith in Jesus Christ, or life in Jesus Christ, is very personal, but it's not private. It is not private at all. It takes a village. And that's why parishes with financial problems, parishes with schisms, parishes with any situation whatsoever need to work through it, because people need their parish. And thank goodness we have ours. I'd like to share a few words that Canon Victor Corrado shared with us last week. He preached a beautiful sermon, then he spoke to your vestry, to your governing board. He talked about a parish. And at first it sounded pretty dismal. He said, statistically, by the year 2050, there will be no Episcopal denomination. There will be no Presbyterian denomination. There will be no Methodist or Lutheran denomination, because we're shrinking and shrinking and shrinking. But he said, be careful what you pray for, because for all these years, we said, our doors are open. We welcome all. All are welcome and none are despised. We have this amazing worship of Jesus Christ. We have this thing, come in. We have a product, come and get it. And then we prayed for our word to go beyond our doors, beyond our gates. And then this horrific pandemic happened. And the beautiful walnut doors
By the way, I thought they were, oh, they're walnut. I had to look this up. Our walnut doors had to close. And we were forced to go beyond our doors and beyond our gates through a camera, through Zoom, through virtual means, any way we can. And we did, and we are. We're having to learn against the grain to do it. But finally, our prayers are being answered. Perhaps this is what parish life is. And so he said then, Father, he convicted us. He said, when the pandemic is over, and when we come back to normal, and we open our walnut doors, when we close the camera doors, that is injustice. Because now we have more people worshiping than we ever had before. And they're not virtual. You are not virtual who come to us through the camera. You are real. We are real parishioners here together, experiencing the Eucharist and the Word and one another. And we're growing in parish life, learning what it is to love God and connect that love to our fellow human beings. It's not easy, and what a challenge. But we have it as a parish. And may we grow together and never forget our Lord's law. Never forget this combination. For on it hangs all the law and the prophet. And on it hangs everything we are or ever can be as a parish of Transfiguration. Amen.
Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, who of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and of Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, the Son of His Father, the
blessings to you on this beautiful Lord's Day. Thank you who join us in physical person. Thank you who join us in true spirit. I have a few announcements today. Next week is one of the principal feasts of the church, the seven principal feasts, the highest feast
and it is the Feast of All Saints. It is the only feast of our Lord Jesus, not based on an event of his life, but his presence in the lives of human beings, complementing well our scriptures today. So do as you can to attend this Sunday. The next day is the Feast of All Souls for the faithful departed. It is our custom, usually during normal times, to have a large music concert and a fabulous mass. Unable to do that this year. Instead, we have a small mass. I'm not able to be live streamed that day, but what I would like for us to do, and I will send an email out, to email names of the people you have loved who have died. And they will be placed in this beautiful, very heavy bronze antique. I can barely lift it. It was given to us by a parishioner who joined us because of our online presence. He lives 6 hours away, but he is a member of this parish and gave this beautiful antique bronze box. Centuries ago, it was to keep holy vessels. We don't need that for today, but now we would put the names in this box every All Souls Day, every year. And we will offer the Mass money for that intention. So email and send to the office the names of people you have loved who have died. Next week also, we begin our education series, beginning our relationship with our Jewish brothers and sisters and what spirituality that brings to us as Christians, taught, led by our own Dr. Karina Hogan. Eventually, and I apologize, you who join us at home, we will learn how to live stream and video these things. But we're just now, we're at the very beginning of this. But I have a meeting this very week to see how we can incorporate more things like our rosary service, our education series, to be online. So stay tuned. But that begins next week, 10 o'clock in the ballroom. And then finally, today begins our annual pledge campaign. And it's very different. Everything has changed, but in a glorious way. And 2 or 3 o'clock this afternoon, an email will go out to every parishioner of the church asking the parishioner to make a pledge for the coming year. But things are very different. Not everyone can make financial pledges. Some can. We ask you to do so prayerfully. Others will make pledges of prayer, pledges of support, pledges of leadership. Pledging should never be exclusive. So I ask every parishioner, when we receive this, fill it out and pledge to the parish. Pledge your prayer, pledge your love. If we don't make our financial goal, but everyone pledges, we've met our goal. And then we can decide anything we need to regarding buildings and finances. But spiritually, we would have won. We would have honored our Lord if every member pledges their support. So you should receive that in the email this afternoon. So again, thank you and bless you. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name, bring offerings, and come into his court. We offer this mass to the greater glory of God with special attention and thanksgiving for this parish and those who worship with us this day from all parts of the world. We continue to lift up the people of the world living in the uncertainty and suffering of our present pandemic of COVID-19. We pray for all frontline workers, healers, and those without privilege or means to obtain medical treatment. We pray for our country as we prepare to elect our leaders. May we face our divisions with a sense of common good and human decency. May we honor the dignity of every human being. We place before the heart of God all those on our parish prayer list who are remembered every day in prayer and love. We pray for St. Matthew's Westminster, our sister parish in London. We pray for those who have died. Remember this week the Right Reverend James Winchester Montgomery, the ninth bishop of Chicago, and this 1-year anniversary week of his death, his heavenly birthday. And remember all those we love but see no longer. May their souls and the souls of all that departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. That we should at all times and all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, who by water and the Holy Spirit hast made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth thy glory in all the world. Therefore, with angels and dark angels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Father. We give thanks unto thee for the goodness and love which thou hast revealed unto us in creation. The calling of Israel is thine own people, and thy word spoken through the prophets, and above all the word made flesh, thy Son, Jesus Christ. For in the fullness of time thou descended to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him thou hast delivered us from evil, and made us worthy to stand before thee. In him thou hast brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. The night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my body, which is given for you, of the new covenant. Do this for the remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as you shall drink it, in remembrance of me. Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And according to his command, O Father, we offer unto thee this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, presenting unto thee from thy creation, O Lord of all, this bread and this cup. We beseech thee, gracious Father, to send thy Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to thy Son and his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. At the last day, put all things in subjection under thy Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, and all thy saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation.
By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover sacrifice for us.
Therefore let us eat the feast. Alleluia.
We do not presume to come to this thy table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who taketh away the sins of the world. Happy are they who are called to his supper. For I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee, for that thou dost feed us in these holy mysteries, with the spiritual food of most precious body and blood, thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, that we are very members and corporate in the mystical body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs and hope of thy everlasting kingdom. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom in thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. And may the holy angels guard and protect you. May blessed Mary and all the saints pray for you. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be amongst you and remain with you forever.
Amen. The Mass is ended. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.